My name is Pieter de Smet. I am a professor of design for experience here at TU Delft, Faculty of Industrial Design Engineering. My background is design, so I was trained as a designer, but then I did a PhD in emotion psychology. So I combined the two worlds, emotion psychology and design.
And can you explain us, why is it important to include emotional in your design process?
Emotions are part of the essence of being human, and emotions drive our behavior. And we all know this from experience. If you're angry, you can see someone who's angry. That's kind of, it's a behavioral thing. And as designers, in the end, you are interested in influencing behavior of people. You want to generate a platform for a certain kind of behavior. And if things don't feel right, people won't buy it, they won't use it, and they won't behave in the way you would like them to behave. The interesting thing about emotions is that it's a multi-componential phenomenon. It consists of several aspects. It consists of a feeling, which is an experience, a subjective feeling. When I'm angry, I can feel the anger, I can feel the rage, and when I'm happy, I can feel it. It's also a behavioral thing. So when I'm angry, I want to attack someone, and then when I'm in love, I want to embrace someone. It's also an expressional thing, and you can see it in someone's face, you can see it in their bodies. And it's the combinations of these things that make up an emotion. So there's always a subjective experience, there's always a bodily component, and there's always a behavioral component. The challenge, if you want to design for emotions, is that emotions are subjective. So different people have different emotions towards the same given stimulus or situation. But at the same time, the process, the underlying mechanisms, they are universal. So we might become angry from different reasons, but the angry system we share. We have the same anger system. So I believe that as a designer, if you understand these underlying mechanisms, then you can make use of that in a design context. It will never give you answers. It will never say that if you want to make someone angry, you have to do this and that, but it will help you to ask the right questions about the people that you are designing for. And to give one basic, simple universal principle is that anyone is only emotional if something happens that either helps them in fulfilling a goal or collides with one of their goals. So if you see that someone is upset, apparently something happened that collided with one of their goals. Otherwise they would not be upset. And there are some universal goals, like the goal to survive. So if the fire alarm goes off, I guess most people, maybe all, will, you know, get upset, get afraid, become anxious, because we all share this universal concern or need to stay alive. So on the universal level, there are a lot of basic universal needs and goals that we all have, but when we go down to the level of actual interactions between people in situations, these universal needs, they translate to very specific needs. But in essence, we are only emotional when something happens that either collides or corresponds with one of those needs. So the question that you need to ask is, what are the needs that people have in this situation? And the beauty is that if you want to design for emotions, is that you can take the existing emotions that people have as an entry point. Because a lot of time people don't know what they want, they don't know their goals, they don't know their needs, but they do have emotions. And as a designer, if you're able to capture those emotions, and you can use all kinds of techniques, simple observation, for example, but also interviewing, or a combination of those, if you capture the emotions, then you know, every emotion is like a little gem, because there's something happened that was important to this person because it touched upon one of their goals, and then you can probe into that and ask them, okay, you were surprised, or you were joyful, or you were a little bit upset. Why were you upset? What happened? And then by probing into that situation, you can find out what was the need that was actualized, that was made, that was awakened in that particular moment. And then you can use those as a starting point for design. One of the things that inspire me as a design researcher is that when people talk about design for emotion, they often think about, I want to stimulate a positive feeling and I want to take away negative feelings, is that there is a huge diversity within that. And my research found that there are at least 24 different positive emotions that you can experience while interacting with products and technology. And that for me is like a palette of opportunities. It's almost like a creative tool. Even if you don't do extensive research, you can take each of these 24 positive emotions and think about how could I facilitate this emotion in the situation where I'm designing for. Why would someone feel hope? Why would someone feel proud? Pride. What generates relief in the situation that I'm designing for? So design for emotion is much more diverse and much more rich than people often think. And an example that I can give is, we had a challenge to design something for people who suffer from dementia, and it had to evoke a positive emotion. And our student, she discovered that one positive emotion that these people, this target group, often do not have anymore is pride. Because to experience pride, you have to have a sense of achievement and a sense of past. And so she developed a game specifically to arouse this feeling of prideness. And it was a sort of a memory game, but it used music from the childhood memories of her participants. So through the game, they could connect to the music of their childhood. And it really generated not only joy, but this sense of pride. And I think that's a nice example, because it shows that when you're using emotions, you can really look into those little nuances.